So hello everyone. First, I would like to thank the organizers of this conference. I'm very glad to be part of the program. I'm Max Bonhomme, teaching in Paris Nanterre University, and I'm very much looking forward to hear the other presentations. Today we'll talk about composite imagery and political propaganda. In the past 10 years, internet memes have become a legitimate academic topic of research. Inquiries into the specificity of this medium have been undertaken by scholars such as Limo Schiffman and Ryan Milner, among others, mainly from the fields of media and communication studies. They have been focusing on the participatory dimension of meme culture, but also on their role in the construction of identities and political communities. While some of these studies have brought enlightening contributions to the understanding of digital culture, to my view, they often lack a stronger focus on visual analysis. So my purpose today will be quite different. I propose to look at that vernacular mimetic imagery from the discipline of artistry in order to understand what internet memes share with former examples of visual communication. Before all that, I must say that what I'm going to present is still an ongoing research. For my doctoral thesis, I've been working on photomontage in the French communist press of the 1930s. I was particularly interested in activist participation, showing how readers were invited to co-produce propaganda imagery according to a logic of collective and anonymous creation, which in certain aspects echoes the contemporary production of internet memes. So by integrating memes to the long history of what I'm calling composite imagery, I'm hoping to highlight some common features of propaganda images throughout history. The idea of contagion will be considered in two ways. In the sense of the virality of images, that is to say their capacity to spread in the public sphere, but also in an iconographic sense, if one thinks of the contagion of one body by another, hybrid creatures, chimeras, and monsters generated by a desire to disqualify people or political collectives. And throughout this presentation, I will also try to lay the groundwork for thinking what a visual populism would be. And I will return to this notion at the end. So to begin, I would like to go back quite a long way to the early 16th century in the context of the Protestant Reformation and the visual propaganda initiated by Martin Luther. At the time of the Reformation, contestation of the power of the church was accompanied by a true image war based on the contagion of symbols and virality of images made possible by the democratization of the printed woodcut. So paradoxically, the Reformation in all its iconoclasm has been a great propagator of images. Some of these images are already quite famous and have been commented by historians of visual satire, such as Champfleury and John Grand Carteret in France, but also Edward Fuchs in Germany. They are seen as important milestones in the history of caricature, but also as the manifestation of an emergent public sphere. A large number of these politico-religious prints rely on the possibilities of what I'm calling the composite image, whether they depict hybrid beings or display a kind of montage of symbols within a single frame. In his classic study of Reformation propaganda, Robert Scribner showed how woodcuts published by Luther and his partisans borrowed from the iconography of defamatory images, or what is known in German as Schandbilder. Schandbilder, much like Pittura Infamante in Italy, are pictures of shame. They are meant to symbolically condemn someone by showing a person in a degrading situation, for example, hanging by the feet or head, or riding a pig. And these images aim to damage the public image of a person or political group. Another way of defaming opponents was to associate them with monsters, devils, and other mythical creatures borrowed from popular culture. The woodcut known as the papal ass is probably the most famous example of such composite imagery for the purpose of Reformation propaganda. The print shows a monstrous being combining the features of a woman, a donkey, a reptile, a bird, and even the trunk of an elephant. Its in quarters consist of a devilish face, which extends into the form of a griffin's head. Legend has it that the creature was discovered in Rome on the banks of the river Tiber in the year 1496. In reality, Cranach woodcut is an adaptation of an engraving previously published in Italy at the end of the 15th century, so a few decades before. And for Champfleury, this practice echoes those of the illustrated press of his time, the 19th century. That is to say, republishing images that have been already published while just changing the caption. And so for us 21st century spectators, this may also evoke the logic of appropriation in meme culture. So at first glance, we have what seems to be a purely, let's say, sensational image, exploiting the anxieties of the time regarding the anomalies of nature. But it is possible that even the first Italian version of the print was already a denunciation of the papacy with the Castel Sant'Angelo visible in the background and the papal coat of arms. In 1523, Philip Melanchthon and Martin Luther published a pamphlet including a textual interpretation of the woodcut. And Melanchthon exploited the association between the monstrous beast and the Pope, proposing an allegorical reading that identified each part of the monster with a negative aspect of the Roman Church. So the papal ass shows how the composite image can lend itself to an allegorical reading. The representation of hybrid beings composed from a multitude of heterogeneous bodies functions as a trigger for reading of the image, where each visual sign has its discursive counterpart. The two prints I'm showing here work on the same principle. The first is a print denouncing Luther, represented as a seven-headed apocalyptic beast. Each one of the seven heads represents one of the many negative figures of Luther. And the second print is a response from the Lutheran side, criticizing the Catholic clergy. In this engraving by Wolfgang Meyerbeck, the propaganda power of Lutheran prints is being staged in a sort of mise en abyme. The Pope is recognizable by his tiara, but he's also wearing donkey ears, a visual deformation device very common in Reformation propaganda. Next to him, a monstrous figure plays a musical instrument made from the head of Johannes Nas, a theologian involved in the Counter-Reformation. Hanging from the tree next to the Pope is one of Luther's published broadsheets. It is a woodcut showing mercenaries defecating in the papal tiara, which is placed on a pedestal bearing the Pope's coats of arms. Originally published in Luther's Depiction of Papacy, this woodcut is another defamatory image playing on the scatological register with a great visual violence. And Mayor Peck's engraving is therefore quite remarkable because it stages the propaganda imagery itself, emphasizing its effect in degrading the papal image. So similarly to what we see today in meme culture, this type of propaganda has a strong self-reflexive dimension. It is a composite image, but it is also the image of an image. Animalization is another typical procedure of defamatory images and early caricature. Reformation propaganda often uses zoomorphism and the idea of inversion between the human and animal worlds. According to Robert Scribner, it reveals a desire to draw on popular culture, particularly in its grotesque and carnivalesque aspects. Quotes, these were systems of signs readily recognizable to the common folk of the time, unquote. The world upside down is one of those recurring themes in popular imagery. It shows animals engaged in human activities. And here, once again, we could draw a parallel with internet memes, where animal pictures are used to comment on human realities. And simply in passing, I would like to mention a book recently published by the collective Disnovation and Nicola Nova. The Bestiary of the Anthropocene presents itself as a reactualization of medieval bestiaries in the age of the Anthropocene. And the composite beings depicted in the book can be read as symptoms of a world in crisis, pretty much like the Tiber monster interpreted by Luther and Melanchthon as political allegories. So let us now turn to another period in history, the 1930s and the growing use of photomontage in propaganda. So in the context of the violent political struggles of the interwar period, there was an alliance between avant-garde artists and communist militancy. John Hartfield, a former member of the Berlin Dada group and a fervent communist activist, is known for using photomontage as a means of anti-capitalist, anti-fascist, and pro-communist propaganda. Although photomontage is sometimes considered a typical process of the artistic avant-garde, I would like to stress that it's above all a means of mass communication, because they were distributed mainly in the illustrated press. And I'm quoting here from Hartfield's words, the montages were not in themselves created to be hung in an exhibition. Their purpose is to have an effect on the masses. To this end, I have appropriated the means of production of this art method in order to spread my sheets in the everyday struggle with the help of the magazine printed in rotogravure in 100,000 copies. The place where they belong is the brain of the masses. John Hartfield's work exemplifies the possibility of the composite image with this way of transforming photographs through caricatural exaggeration and its way of using monstrous imagery into the service of political satire. And the communist press of the interwar period was particularly fond of photomontage aimed at ridiculing the political figures of the moment. And in this regard, photomontage perpetuates a tradition of satirical imagery using rhetorical devices such as animalization and reification of the human figure. The participation of readers in the communist press of the 1930s offers interesting parallels with contemporary internet memes. For example, readers were invited to cut out published images or to invent a caption that would give political meaning to the photographs. In this way, readers were led to become editors themselves, becoming aware that every published image is a result of constructed discourse. This echoes Walter Benjamin's remarks about the captioning of images in his essay, The Author as Producer, where he says, quote, what we require of the photographer is the ability to give his picture a caption that wrenches it from modish commerce and gives it a revolutionary use value, unquote. In this example from French communist publication, we notice such recaptioning of press photographs, but also a typical binary composition. The antagonism between social classes is visually reinforced by their separation within the printed space. And because of its extreme mannequin simplicity, this method of binary opposition could be considered an archetypal example of the visual populism I'm trying to define. And we can find previous examples of such binary opposition in Reformation propaganda, for example, in this book by Luther and Melanchthon, Passional Christi und Antichristi. So this brings me to the more specific study of contemporary memes. From the outset with this first example, we are confronted again with binary opposition, but also with a form of rereading of the history of political imagery. It is very symptomatic that some of the binary compositions found in Soviet propaganda are being updated today in the form of memes. So this is the case with the famous propaganda poster by poet Vladimir Mayakovsky, which has become a meme known as Porky. In itself, Porky simply resurrects the old topos of animalizing the bourgeoisie in the guise of a pig. But what interests me here is more the historical awareness of meme creators when they merge a Soviet propaganda poster with a Drake video, for example. So the use of memes as a tool for political propaganda has been widely discussed in relation to the presidential elections in the US that led to the victory of Donald Trump in 2016. On forums such as 4chan, which is predominantly right-wing and far-right, it was mockingly proclaimed that, quote, the left can't meme. But at the same time, there was also a radicalization of the American left and an increasing use of memes for a different kind of propaganda with an overtly Marxist content. This meme exemplifies exactly these issues. It appeared in the troubled period of Donald Trump's term in office, which has seen both a rise of the far right and an increasing radicalization of the far left. It is the iteration of a meme known as the Dust Storm Dog that shows the infamous Doge meme pasted on the photography of a dust storm. Doge is usually a character with rather friendly connotations, but here it takes the form of this huge cloud of dust that threatens to cover a suburban landscape. As is often the case in memes, the allegory is made explicit by the addition of text. The cloud is designated as class consciousness in the Marxist sense, progressively gaining ground in American society. I'm proposing to see this example as a sort of meta-meme, a meme that is in fact a commentary on the visual culture of the internet itself. Indeed, the author of the meme seems to imply that the cause of this growing class consciousness is are the new means of communication made available by the internet, so memes themselves. So the increasing polarization of online political debates, embodied and supported by meme culture, may have contributed to the resurgence of the radical left in the US. So with the last example, we have seen the extent to which political memes are really about contagion in the sense of dissemination. But now if we turn to issues of iconography, we can also notice how much hybrid and monstrous figures populate the internet imaginary. In this example, which is an ironic take on the recent election of Joe Biden, we are dealing with a particularly complex composite image with a 3D rendering close to that found in video games. But meme culture is best known for its celebration of amateurism, and in particular for a certain category of drawings made on Microsoft Paint software. This style, labeled Internet Ugly by Nick Douglas, takes advantage of the badly made aspects of the drawings, assumed as such, and willingly exaggerated. It is precisely because these drawings are poorly done that they are funny. But surprisingly, this celebration of visual amateurism, which is part of the DNA of meme culture, leads to some connections with older imagery. Recently, internet users have compared paint drawings with some monstrous figures found in medieval manuscripts. And that reminded me of a book by the historian Jurgis Baltrusaitis, who compiled all these sort of hybrid creatures. So to summarize, I would like to return to the notion of contagion and specify the different ways in which it applies to the corpus of images gathered here. Whether we are talking about the woodcuts of the Reformation, John Hartfield's montage, or internet memes, the idea of contagion is first and foremost understood at the level of the medium itself. These are mass reproducible images made to be disseminated to a large audience and thus to intervene in a political context. Secondly, the idea of contagion comes into play at the iconographic level. The alteration of the human body works as a symbolic disfigurement, an image act, so to say, operating in a defamatory mode. It should be noted, however, that in the case of memes, this visual violence is very often played out in an ironic way. And finally, I would like to suggest that the common thread between the forms of propaganda I have presented here is a form of visual populism. And by populism, I mean here in the simplest formulation of the concept, a radical opposition between the people and the elite. In the case of Lutheran propaganda, this takes the form of a visual defamation of the clergy, nourished by numerous references to popular culture. And similarly, in Hartfield's montage, we have a humor which is very much rooted in German proletarian culture. It was through humor, including black humor and bad taste, that Hartfield sought to reinforce class consciousness and support for communism. Now, considering platforms such as 4chan, one could ask whether the culture of amateurism and anonymity that emerged from these forums does not also participate to a kind of visual populism. These forms of online politicization can bring to power political figures defined as populist, as we have seen in the last years. Now, to conclude, it seems to me that in terms of political strategy, it is important to reflect on the ways these modes of visual communication can be appropriated for the purposes of progressive politics, if reality is not to become a grotesque farce. So thank you very much.